and privilege to welcome you to yet another edition of the BW Dialogue. Today we have a guest who's a giant. You know, he's had accomplishments and responsibilities that a lot of people dream of. He's sometimes when you meet him, it looks like he's just getting started. He has zest for life. He has stories, and I hope today he regales us with some stories. Off the screen, you get a little better stories than you get on screen. With this introduction, let me welcome the former chairman of SEBI, Mr. M. Damodaran, for the BW Dialogue. Thank you, Mr. Damodaran, for joining us. Mr. Damodaran is still very active on the boards of many companies. He chairs Educational Institutions Board, one of the IIMs. He's the chairman of the board. He does some heavy lifting on some heavy boards, and they use his acumen and his experience for governance and moving forward. He also does an annual conference on governance every year, where I can say India Inc. converges. So, as I said, he's somebody who's very active. First of all, Mr. Damodaran, how have been the last 6 months for you? What has kept you personally and professionally busy?
Oh, I think the last 6 months have been as busy as any of the months that preceded it and any of the months that will succeed it, largely because work didn't go away. There were webinars, there were other interactive ways. We do a lot of, in my company, we do a lot of by invitation round tables where we get a lot of very cerebral participants who are unafraid to speak their mind, and therefore we get a lot out of those. That has kept me a little busy. I would have liked to say that I used this time for writing. I did not do it adequately. My initial thoughts were that these 6 months could lead to a book. That hasn't happened. Maybe the next 6 months, hopefully, will be better than the last 6 months. Otherwise, I've been confined to Delhi, but confined in a physical sense, not in the sense of being able to connect, because while stories of gloom and doom were there, I think Zoom took over our lives and there. So thereafter, it has been one ride along Zoom and several other platforms. It's been good. Would it have been better? Most certainly, if I could meet people personally, because I love meeting people. But that hasn't happened.
Thank you, Mr. Damodaran. I would have loved to know, what would this book be on? Is this a book biography? Is it about your experiences? Is it a commentary on governance? What would this book be when it comes out in 6 months?
If I write a book on governance, it would be very difficult to get people to read it, because I don't know whether governance as a subject of a book would interest too many people. There's far too many webinars, conferences. People have governance coming out of their ears. Yes, I'm also partly responsible for that because of the webinars we do. No, it won't be on governance. As and when the book happens, I'd like to say when rather than if it happens, it will be really not a chronological account, but of several interesting incidents in my life where I have been, you know, privileged to have a ringside seat of things that went right, more often things that went wrong. It won't be preachy, it will not be hopefully pedantic, it will be more conversational, but that is in the future. As and when it happens, sure it will.
Okay, hopefully in 2021, we look forward to reading it and maybe around your book have a conversation again. Let me at this point ask you something that is on everyone's minds. COVID has led to a healthcare issue. It has also led to a livelihood issue. The business and economy has been impacted. What is your commentary on the current business environment?
Well, the current business environment leaves a lot to be desired. It's not that we should hold COVID entirely responsible, because even before COVID decided to pay us a visit, and it was, of course, overstayed its welcome by a long, long time. Even before that, the economy was moving southwards. You could see signals that were not very positive. Well, it wouldn't have led to 23.9% negative, but certainly you would have been looking at numbers of an economy that wasn't going to grow the way we were growing earlier, and a lot of things that needed to be fixed. So COVID impacted us in some sense, and some sense positively also, in addition to the huge negative impact. It did impact on livelihoods. It certainly impacted on lives. Both lives and livelihoods were adversely impacted. But I think what it also taught us was that we can live with less. We possibly are living with more than we need to live, those of us who are relatively privileged, and that we could share some of the wealth with people that are less privileged, create more opportunities for people to stand on their feet. I'm not a great believer in handouts. I believe in that old adage, don't give fish to somebody, give him a fishing net and teach him how to fish. Because if you're giving fish today, tomorrow and the day after, you'll be feeding the guy. It will impact negatively on his self-esteem. It will certainly hurt whatever productivity resides in him. As a temporary measure, yes, you need handouts, but you cannot have an economic restructuring model that is largely based on handouts. That is one. The second is that I think corporate chieftains have now understood what frontline leadership means in terms of getting everybody to rally around you, seeing the commonality of purpose, working towards that shared purpose in a manner in which there are less personal agendas than there were in the past. And when you have a crisis at your doorstep, I think you do better than you do in normal times. When a boxer is pushed against the ring, that is when he fights the hardest, because it's a fight for survival. And therefore, I think there are some positives. We need to take those positives away. But it's a huge climb that we need to address in terms of how to get the economy back on its feet. There are people that have paid a very, very serious price. We have something for them. I think that's work in progress, hopefully.
Thank you, Mr. Damodaran. You rightly said that crisis brings out the best, and it has brought leadership to the fore. It's a time to be able to be relevant in the 3C economy. I call it the compassionate and caring economy. I call it the collaborative economy, and I call it the contactless economy. So you have to reimagine your businesses in those. But now let me go on to ask you a question that possibly everyone wants to ask from somebody like you. What is the way to fix the economy? What can the government do to fix the economy?
Let me tell you something that I have shared with a large number of audiences, which is that every problem, you need to first have a diagnosis, then a prescription, and then a treatment. You should follow what the doctors do. Your diagnosis is wrong, your prescription will be wrong, and the treatment will obviously misfire. The good thing is, I think our diagnosis is reasonably right of where we are. There was a point of time when we were living in denial, when we were saying that things were hunky-dory when they were not. Today, the good thing is we are not in denial. I think everybody accepts there's a problem. It's a huge problem, and that you need to fix that problem. Now, what is it you can do? Again, I'm a firm believer in zero-based budgeting. Because whatever you want to do, you need money to do it. Now, if you believe that the government doesn't have money, the government throws up its hands, the government, the federal government, denies the state governments their legitimate use in regard to GST, and then the state governments have to cope with the problem of COVID and, you know, the health-related issues, etc., then you are barking up the wrong tree. You need to start out by saying, yes, I will find the resources. And how do you do that? Even today as we speak, there is both in the federal budget as well as in the state budgets, several items that we can do without. In there in the past, for some reason, some of the schemes and programs are not required to be persistent with. That itself will generate some money. We need more money. There are, I am told, offers by multilateral organizations to make money available to address the COVID-related issues. I think we need to take that money, not just throw it at the problem. Throwing money at the problem is not going to help. You need to empower people after having discussed solutions with them. You need to incentivize them. You need to hold them accountable for what they do. If all of that happens, I think we will be moving in the right direction. Will we get to where we want to get in double quick time? No, it's going to take a while. Nothing's going to happen tomorrow or the day after. But we will have the satisfaction that we are moving in the right direction, we are on the right path, and that we have what it takes to put this behind us. I believe we are a resilient country. We've lived with all manner of problems, and we will somehow find a way out of this. But traditional solutions and then looking to the RBI is not going to help, because there's only so much monetary policy can do. It's time for the fiscal policy to step up and demonstrate that that is where the action is going to be. I personally think that trying to fire off the shoulders of banks is not the answer. If you say that I have this great program, and more than two-thirds of the program is persuading, cajoling, exhorting banks to lend, when at the same time you have investigative agencies questioning their credit decisions with the benefit of hindsight, treating every bona fide error as an ab initio of mala fide decision, in that kind of a situation, banks are not going to lend. If banks are not going to lend, clearly the economy is not going to get the fuel that it needs, which is credit. So I think you need a properly constructed and conceived package which is sector specific. You can't have a one size fits all approach. Sector specific, and then there are some areas where I think we've not demonstrated courage. Take aviation, for example. I read that one airline from Europe wants to operate 100 plus flights into India, and it's going to start. Are you allowing our airlines to go outside? No, you're not. You're saying we'll decide that later, except for Vande Bharat and the bubble flights. You're not opened up that. The others are sending flights in and they're all ready. I think you need courage. You need decision making. You cannot afford a dilatory approach.
And fast decision making, physical, on the go, so to say. Considered nuanced, but on the go, because the environment is such. Also, Mr. Damodaran, I'll come to the financial markets, and I'll come how to the fact, to your view on how the liquidity can be brought back. And a lot of experts believe it's a credit issue too, because we don't know, we have receivables, but we don't know the quality after COVID, right? We can make a guess, but we really don't know the quality of those receivables. I'll come to those issues. But let me try and ask you, you talked about fiscal policy, monetary policy, fiscal discipline, the measures that can be done. Tell us, shall we go on to print on more currency and sensitize the rating agencies, and beyond that, not worry? What's your view on that?
Absolutely. We cannot be puritanical in our approach to this problem. Yes, there will be an impact on the fisc. There will be deficits that credit rating agencies don't like. But to live in fear of credit rating agencies and what they might say, they also live in this world. They know what's happening. They know there is an issue. Yes, maybe a formulaic approach might lead to a negative perception by a credit rating agency.
There's no cookie cutter approach. There's no cookie cutter.
You cannot have a situation where you say, okay, you know, I can't run up a deficit while people are batting both for lives and livelihoods. That's not on. You have to print currency, go ahead and print it. I would say hit the pause button on the Fiscal Responsibility Act.
Okay. Now, let me come to the most, you know, financial services. So you had a huge career in the government. You worked all across the country. So So you have a certain, and after your career in the government, you continue to advise firms, continue to be active. So tell us, how can the liquidity be brought back into the, you know, so to say, the country? And what kind of reforms are needed in the financial sector? Because banks have become super conservative, and NBFCs have don't money at a, they don't have the money, or and plus they've become conservative. So tell us, how will the liquidity come back? At the end, an Indian entrepreneur can only grow if there is capital and the cost of capital is low.
A very valid point. Ultimately, things will improve only if banks lend. Banks will lend only if, to use your words, they become less conservative and start taking decisions again very quickly. The problem really is, have you given them the confidence that decisions that might go wrong will not visit them, you know, later in life? They will not have to account for it. Not, I'm not for a moment saying accountability is not important. I believe it is one of the three pillars for any organization, alongside both empowerment and incentivization. But that said, if banks don't lend, nothing is going to happen. Nothing is going to happen. How do you get banks to lend? You get banks to lend, of course, by the right policy framework. And I dare say RBI has done enough to persuade the banks to lend. But if the transmission is not happening, it is also not happening, because traditionally there has been a lag. In addition to that, how does credit reach the person who needs credit? The guys that you want to lend to don't want to borrow it from you because they're unsure of the future, they're not making the right investment decisions. So it's not as if banks are seeing a whole lot of good projects that are coming to them. The guys that are coming to you are the guys that you wouldn't lend to in normal times. So you have the problem of adverse selection that kicks in. And on top of that is this fear that should a decision go wrong, what will happen to me a few years down the line? This is something that can and must be fixed. If that doesn't get fixed, if you expose them to the, let's say, the investigative skills, undoubted skills of agencies whose skill sets don't remain in the area of credit appraisals, how do you take a good credit decision and stuff like that? But just look at the end. Okay, well, this didn't work out. Didn't work out maybe for a number of reasons. Now, unfortunately, what has happened, that over a period of time, we have stood jurisprudence on its head. It has become a question, not just in banking, but even elsewhere, especially with all the noise that the media makes, guilty until proven innocent. And given the tardy judicial processes, you will get proved innocent only much later in life, when it ceases to be a matter of even academic interest. Maybe you have moved on to another place, and that is when the judgment will come. So given all of that, I think somewhere we need to say, yes, we need these guys to lend. How do we give them the protection that they need in order to see that they lend? I don't think it's shortage of money. They have the money to lend. There are no projects and there is no courage. That really is the mother problem, if I may say so. If that doesn't happen, nothing much will happen, no matter what our intentions are, how good they are.
Thank you so much for being so honest and so candid, and coming from somebody like you, who's widely respected and still in the game very much, you know, understands issues historically and understands the nuances of current, you know, times. Thank you for saying what you said. I also want to, you know, when you were saying this, I was thinking, one of the things that is also always done is to blame everything on the bureaucracy. You know, the country doesn't do well, the policy is wrong, the decision making has happened because the bureaucrats are not doing. So what do you have to say about that, Mr. Damodaran?
Bureaucracy is an instrument. Is it right to blame an instrument when things go wrong?
Not at all.
You must use bureaucracy properly. They are policy advisors. You should get them to advise on policy, but the ownership of policy resides in the political executive, not in the bureaucracy. which is unelected and less representative of what the common man wants or should get. So I personally think laying the blame for everything at the doorstep of the bureaucracy is not the answer. In fact, there is a group of which I am a part where I saw a lot of very, very enlightened economists and others say that, the India's problem is really the bureaucracy. And I suggested to them as a former bureaucrat, why don't we do one thing? Why don't we just abolish the bureaucracy? Say from tomorrow morning, and I'm not talking about the IAS or the IPS, so that level, bureaucracy right down the line up to the village level. That is the sum total of bureaucracy. If all of them are non-performing, abolish them, hand it over to a bunch of economists, NGOs, maybe retired judges, maybe some people from the media who have the point of view on everything. I heard this said, and this is something that interested me. It said, India has the highest per capita opinion in the world. Whatever else we might not have, highest per capita opinion we have. Everybody knows how to do somebody else's job. That is one of the problems. They don't realize what is it that the bureaucracy contends with in terms of populist demands being made on them, in terms of transactional interventions. And let us thank God that given all these constraints, we have a bureaucracy that is not totally non-performing, perhaps underperforming for whatever it is. There is also fear in the bureaucracy. Of course. Bureaucrats are also worried, like bankers are, about the questions being second-guessed by somebody down the line. Bureaucrats have an advantage. There is an old system that the English taught us. Not that I give credit to the English for many things, but they said you can do what you like, provided you do it for reasons to be recorded in writing. Your only defense is that the records must show why you did what you did. But if you say, I got a phone call and therefore I had to do this, there are ways of dealing with that also. I don't want to get into the details. If you get a phone call from somebody, there is a way of bringing it on record. You write back and saying, this is what you told me on the phone, and unless I hear anything to the contrary, I'm going to do it this fashion, provided it's consistent with law and regulation. I don't think, just to put it in a nutshell, I don't think our bureaucracy is worse than bureaucracy anywhere else, or regrettably better than bureaucracy anywhere else. There are lots of skill sets, there's lots of challenges. There are lots of things that they have to deal with, have to put up with, have to countenance. And yet, something happens. After all, it is bureaucrats who look after the Kumbh Mela. It's bureaucrats that, of course, people credit Nandan Nilekani with the concept, but below him, there were bureaucrats that delivered on Aadhaar. There are bureaucrats that run the most complicated elections in India. Who runs it? All of those people are bureaucrats. It's not that they are a special category when they go and sit in another office. You must empower them, trust them. If trust disappears, then rust will creep into the system. We can't afford it.
Thank you, Mr. Damodaran. Because often I hear that, so I thought there wouldn't be a better person to kind of address that. And you addressed it beautifully. Let me move on to, there are questions, comments on the Zoom. Deepak Agarwal has posted a question also. It's about financial market reforms. For the last 20 years, in some way, we've been talking about it. We've done something about it. What else needs to be done? How fast? How radical?
Well, when you talk in terms of reforms, everything that does not appeal to somebody needs to be reformed. When banks were nationalized in 69 and thereafter 1980, it was described as reform. Shareholding in banks was open to the public, it was also defined as reform. When banks get privatized fully, that will also be called reform. So reform is contextual depending on the constituency that is reaching out to them. Now, what reforms do we need in the financial market? You certainly need, if you look at the securities market, for example, you certainly need more investors in the market.
You certainly not need... in the market. And financial penetration of the investing in stock market is for a country like India, the lowest. It's an historic.
That is because for some reason, two things have happened. One, we've had a number of setbacks in terms of scandals in the market. Every few years, something or the other went wrong. And what happens is also the other thing is that our markets move without rhyme or reason. I mean, we had a minister earlier who said whenever the market went up, he said fundamentals are very strong. The next day when the market went down, then you looked for explanations that had nothing to do with the market. Now, these explanations don't wash beyond a point. Fundamentals don't change overnight. Right? That your stock price goes up one day and comes down the next day is not a playoff fundamental. Now, the real issue is, if you look at the preamble to the SEBI Act, it talks in terms of regulation of the market, development of the market, and the protection of interest. I read this conjunctively, both development and regulation, in order to serve the interest of the investors, to protect them. These are the ends, these are the means, the interest of investors is the end. Now, obviously, if that is done well, you will get more investors in the market. If the development function is taken care of, you will get investors from within and outside. You will get more retail investors. Unfortunately, yes, there are more. Some come through the mutual fund route, but you need much, much more investing. As an asset class, does this attract the common man? Because he or she is looking at the safety of bank deposits. When you look at safety, liquidity, and returns, the poorer you are, the higher safety ranks in that. Returns comes at the end. You want your capital to be safe. You want liquidity because at some stage you may need to access the money. You're willing to live with 1% or less of returns, and that's happening with pensioners, for example. Other asset classes, I've seen investors coming there, uninformed investors, some of them, and coming to grief straight up. So you will have to make the market safe. Investor education is a very high priority. In fact, that is at the base of market reforms is the informed investor. If there are informed investment decisions, the market will behave better. When a market behaves better, it can be home to better products, more investors, institutional as well as Indian investors. Today, when money comes in from outside, we think it is a vote in favor of our markets. No, it is a vote at the level at which your indices are. These people invest all over the world, and when they find some indices underperforming and are likely to underperform, they pull money out of there and put it in a market where the prices seem to be going better. It's not a vote on systems, safety, etc. I think reform should focus on what's it for the investor. There are three people in the market, the issuer, intermediary, and the investor. And you'll have to look at the interests of all of them. Simplify processes. Have less regulations. Don't wake up every morning and write a new regulation. In fact, the regulatory regime should undergo a significant change. You need to address the stock of regulations. Take out what is irrelevant, then look at the flow to see that only those that survive the regulatory impact assessment test actually find the place in the book of regulations. If all of that doesn't get done, this business of, let us change this regulatory organization. We have enough regulatory organizations in the country. We, of course, took off one by merging the Forward Markets Commission with the Commodities Markets with SEBI. But then you created a pension regulator when you put that job to the insurance regulator. Because insurance and pension go together.
Thank you. Now, there's been a talk, you talked about this merger. There's been a talk about having a single financial regulator. Right now, there are how many, right? And there has been some steps from the government in that sense. But still, we have a long, long way to go. So, when do you think this single regulator will happen? Is it a good thing? Is it a bad thing? What are the pros and cons?
It's not necessarily a good thing, and we have international experience to show that. When Northern Rock failed, it was attributed to the presence of three institutions which needed to take a call, and during the weekend, they did not consult each other. Monday morning, Northern Rock failed. in England. Then you tinkered with the regulatory process, with the regulatory institutions. I don't think the problem resides in that. The problem resides in creating, in doing capacity building in regulatory organizations. Why do regulatory organizations not measure up? I give an example from my days in SEBI. We had four people with a CA qualification in an organization that critical. Four people. We had not recruited lawyers for quite some time. I went to the campuses and brought a lot of young lawyers. Regrettably, most of them have left. I wish some at least had stayed on. We need to create the right capacities. Securities law was not taught in our law colleges, except the government law college in Mumbai, which had a one-year course. It wasn't even taught, even in the premier law institutes, as an area of consequence. And this is important for the economy. Now, you don't need a single regulator. I would also say, but don't add more regulators. Every time you discover that there might be a regulatory gap, it doesn't call for a regulator. The world of regulation has regulatory gaps and regulatory overlaps. Neither of these need to be addressed. By creating another regulator, we have enough. We don't even need new regulations from existing regulators. There's enough of regulations also. We need better enforcement.
Fantastic. So you're saying if governance is less regulated, it is better. That's what I'm hearing. Rightly regulated, less, more is, you know.
Let me put it differently. I say that we must have more regulation and less regulations. That S is the problem element. Have more regulation, which means that enforce regulation better, but don't write out new regulations. You know, I'm fond of saying this, and I'll take the liberty of saying it yet again. Now the situation has been, give me a problem and I will write you a regulation. That's not the way to conduct regulation, especially post-2008.
Fantastic. I'm seeing the comments that are coming in. Let me ask you my last two questions. One more question that has come in, we'll take them at the end. Deepak Agarwal's question in some way you already answered. Sameer Vadhan is asking his own question. But let me ask my last two questions, one a professional and one a personal. Professional one. I mean, you already alluded to that, you know, the fundamentals don't change and the stock market goes up.
Yes.
And then one day it comes down and then you have to do explaining. But what is the explanation between the disconnect on the current situation on the street and the disconnect at the Dalal Street? The Dalal Street and the real street seem to be so much far away from each other. What do you attribute that to? First of all, do you agree that they are not?
Oh, yes, there is. The numbers tell the tale. I think it's fairly clear that there is a disconnect. Now, there are one or two reasons why this has happened. One, and I think no one could have put it better than a former Prime Minister of India when he was asked, how do you explain the behavior of the market? The same situation. The economy was moving in one direction, the markets are moving somewhere else. And I think he put it very well. He said, the market has its own logic. I will not attempt to understand. The logic of the market is very simple logic. If, in regard to the, not the economy, if in regard to a sector or a stock, an investor believes that tomorrow is better than today, he's going to buy. If he believes that, these are not, all of them are not investors. Many of them are here today, gone tomorrow. They will see which way it moves. Many of them are there for short-term gains. Then you have institutional investors who see, okay, bunch of foreign investors have exited at a particular time. Suddenly prices have come down. There are easy pickings in the market, so you can move in and originally, it used to be said that these were on the basis of phone calls from Delhi. But now I am told that it is on the basis of investing opportunities that have arisen. And then, of course, there is this question of larger investors investing in several markets. They also look at where other markets are. are other markets underperforming? It's all a question of, you know, relatively being better or worse than somebody. If they believe that your markets are safe, and then some of them believe that we have the resilience to tide over all of this and we will be moving to new levels, why not take positions in the market now? So that is the reason why markets do not reflect what happens every day in the economy. There's a huge positive news, yes, the market will factor it. It's hugely negative, the market will certainly factor that into that. But a general situation of an economy that is not doing too well is not going to reflect on a daily basis in the marketplace.
Fantastic. Now, my last question, you know, the Prime Minister 4.5 months back made a clarion call for being self-reliant, for being Atmanirbhar. Now, there are three things that come into play if you want to be self-reliant as a country or as a community of entrepreneurs, business people. One is the cost of land. If you're a manufacturing company, then is the cost of labor, people. But the most important is the cost of capital, right? Now, do you think we have the right cost of capital, and the other two parameters are also right, that we'll be self-reliant in some years? Is that a pipe dream, or do you think that is possible?
Well, it's a good objective. Let me start by saying it's a good objective. But then again, it depends on what he meant by being Atmanirbhar. Right. Several people have misinterpreted it to treat it as equivalent to Oliver Goldsmith's The Self-Sufficient Village Manor, where everything is produced and consumed in that. It is not that we are looking at being self-sufficient in every commodity, every service. We will be a part of the international thing, but we will be strong partners in those relationships. We will be important persons that cannot be easily discounted. We will bring to the table our own strengths. Certainly, goods and services will originate from places where it is cheapest and best to originate from. So, I think as an objective, it is good. How will we get there? Clearly, there is no magic wand by which we can reduce the cost of capital in this country. We are a high interest rate economy, no matter what the RBI might do. As it is, even today as we speak, pensioners are rightly protesting that look, all our money is in bank deposits. If you say you want to make lending costs cheap, therefore you will reduce my returns, where do I go? That is a constituency that has got to get addressed. The second is that you need long-term capital. We don't have institutions that provide long-term capital. Our pension funds can provide, but are underutilized. Insurance is another source.
Sorry, I'm interrupting you for the first time. Or they're putting money in LIC and IDBI. You know, LIC is putting money in IDBI. IDBI, I mean, I know it's a special place in your heart. You're able to revive it, but it was in a mess. And since then, it hasn't been built upon, you know. It could have gone on to become a very big bank and a financial institution, unfortunately. The money is going there.
I think what happened with IDBI, since you raised this and you said it is something that has a place in my heart, most certainly it has, because for the first time in its first 40 years, when I went to IDBI, it was going to declare a loss in the next quarter. So I needed to think on my feet, find a solution, and we created the Stressed Asset Stabilization Fund, took out 9,000 crores into the fund. And through a method where the government issued bonds, the fund bought the assets from us at the prices at which we held them on the bonds. But that's a story that I don't want to take too much time on. Now, IDBIS had good things going for it. It was a very small organization in terms of numbers. And once the asset side was cleaned, it should have been easy to do it after the merger with the bank, so that you're also addressing the liability issue. Otherwise, IDBI had a problem raising deposits. when you have changes in the plan, the philosophy, the structure, mid course, you know, you're in the middle of the river, you need to swim on the other side. You know you have what it and yet you decide to change tack there, then you will get close to drowning. And I think there have been far too many ships, and of course now LIC has become the institution of last resort for bailing out organizations. LIC's funds should go in the form of long-term instruments for building infrastructure, as should the coal miners fund, and we have several of those. Today we have a situation where the Canadian pension funds are investing big money in it. CalPERS invests all over the world. This is all pension funds, because pension funds are long-term funds. We don't have long-term funds, therefore we have to think of is there a way of providing budgetary support, and this is not the best call on budget resources. Or access funds from overseas. I think the cost of capital is not going to get lower. Land is going to be an issue. Labor productivity is an issue. Because while we claimed that our wages were low, wages have gone up, but labor productivity is a huge across the board. The other day I was listening to somebody on a television program, one of the experts, who said that yes, we have lost several million jobs. That's not the issue. The point is how productive is our residual labor today. Our agriculture is delivering. It's trying to bail out the rest of the economy. But even agricultural productivity is low. Our crop intensity is low. There are several things that need to be fixed on this. If somebody works on it, we have the solutions. It is moving from awareness to adoption. We are at the awareness stage. We need to take the big steps and adopt it. We will not be competitive as far as cost of capital is concerned. We certainly will not be. We need to figure out what then are our competitive strengths and work on that, and then become Atmanirbhar over a period of time.
Beautiful. I think, you know, I was gonna, today we did a story on the report of the expert committee on resolution framework for the COVID-related stress. I'm talking of business.
Yes.
Which Mr. K.V. Kamath chaired.
Yes.
And I was reading the committee and we did a story. And some of the things that you're saying today to me resonate, you know, they aren't saying in the similar words, but it's, of course, there is a little more immediate and short-term, like fix the, you know, immediate thing focus. But directionally, they're talking similar things as you.
What I like the best is that they've identified 26 sectors and not prescribed a common approach. I think they've seen a problem in its true light, yes. And they've stated that. That, I think, is really the big thing.
Mr. Damodaran, it's been a pleasure talking to you. Just before I ask one or two audience questions, my last question to you. You've achieved everything. You've achieved respect professionally. Built institutions, you turned around institutions, you have brought up two young adults who are doing well in their professionals, your sons. By God's grace, you have a healthy disposition. You've done everything that needs to be done. Is there something left for Mr. Damodaran to do? Does Mr. Damodaran have a bucket list?
Oh, it's a huge bucket list. There are several things there that should have been done. Certainly more writing should have been done. Certainly some hobbies that have been given up. I do a little bit of coaching and mentoring. That is going to be there till the last day. In fact, I made one wrong statement the day I left SEBI, and I was interviewed by Shekhar Gupta, and he asked me, so what next? I said, the shoes have been on for close to 40 years. I should take them out and go and get a pedicure. That hasn't happened. The shoes are still on, and the way things are going, they will be on. And the philosophy that I like is captured in four words that Atalji explained when he was asked a question. Not tired, not retired. There's a lot to be done. I can't even list it out for you, but maybe more reading, maybe more writing, maybe more speaking, maybe more coaching and mentoring, and maybe also watching more football on television.
Good, Mr. Damodaran. Lots of questions. I'm only taking one, which I possibly resonates a lot with you. It's about corporate governance. It's about governance. What do you think COVID will do to governance? Will it enhance it, or it will get pushed to the sidelines because right now it's about survival? What do you have to say to that?
Let me mention three or four things. For several years, corporate governance was seen as expenditure and not as investment. That was the beginning of the problem. Then you had some learned persons who said that because you have better corporate governance, it doesn't translate to a company doing better. It's only much later that people discovered that other things remaining the same, a better governed company is a more sustainable company, and companies are for the long term, they are not meant for the short term. I think that understanding has already stabilized. What COVID brought was a challenge of leadership. There were, of course, immediate issues to be addressed. There was fire to be put out. When there is a fire in your house, you cannot think in terms of how to reorder the furniture in a manner consistent with governance. You've got to put out the fire first. So I grant that to them. But the fires have been more or less addressed. You don't need to call in the fire brigade to address those fires that are today in corporate India. But that said, it's not as if corporate India, and I'm proud of them for this, abandoned governance practices along the way. I think somewhere the realization dawned that you need to do that. Yes, some people would have adopted shortcuts. Some people would have adopted shortcuts for the long term. And said, we will get back here on the high road after we fix this problem. I have no quarrel with that also. So long as your intention is to get back on the high road of governance. And what is governance at the end of the day? I want to say this. Is many people, you know, complicate governance by multi-sentence definitions, and then you need to demystify it and deconstruct it. Governance is very simple. Doing the right things at the right time in the right manner for the right reasons. That is all there is to it. I think corporate India has done that reasonably well. Is it as good as I would like to be? No. I don't think they also would like it. It will always be work in progress. So long as the direction is right, I think they can sleep peacefully.
Thank you so much, Mr. Damodaran. We could go on talking to you, but thank you for talking to VW Business World. I think you should now do a chat show, talk show. Every week, host a show for us where you talk to the corporate India and India and bring out the best. Because what they tell to you and what you would understand could enrich the lives of the viewers. So I think I'm going to chase you on that. But it's been a pleasure talking to you, and we look forward to more conversations with you.
May I share an anecdote with you before I sign off? I was talking to my grandson, and I explained to him why listening is important and why God has given us 2 ears and 1 mouth so that the proportion is right. And I took a lot of time to explain this to him. And when I finished, he told me, but you've been talking for a long time. That's the problem with chat shows.
No, but that's, you have to have the right amount of listening and talking, and there is preparation, there is perspective, and the people. I call it the 3 P's of a chat show. One is perspective. You have the background, you understand things. Second is very importantly, the person. Who's the person you bring? And third is preparation. If you do these 3 right, then the balance of talking and listening happens. So I'm learning myself. I'm a student. But hopefully someday get to the balance. But thank you for talking to us. It's always a pleasure. I know today we didn't get your stories that we get offline, but someday those two. Thank you so much. Okay. Good evening. God bless you.
Thank you.
For those
Thank
of you who missed it, you can watch this on the Business World YouTube page. It will also a transcript of the interview will also be in the next issue of BW Business World, plus on businessworld.in which is a 30 million traffic site every month. So if you missed it, you can revisit this conversation. Thank you. God bless you. Good evening.